His name is Michael Knight, a lover of fast cars and high-speed adventure. Its name is Kit, a talking car and a wonder on wheels. Put the two together and you've got Knight Rider, a crime-stopping duo that's second to none. After 41 years, it's safe to say that Michael, Kit, and the entire Flag Gang are cemented in our pop culture as one of the defining TV shows of the 1980s. I occasionally run across various top 10 lists on the internet about the show, but it seems every single one of them gets some, most, or all of their facts wrong. So today, I'm going to present to you our first top list, the top 10 things you might not know about Knight Rider. Alright, I guess technically it's not our first top list, right? We did the top 10 best episodes of Knight Rider, the top 10 worst episodes of Knight Rider, so I guess it's a continuation. Anyways, if you like this type of content, let us know below in the comments, maybe we'll do others. But before we start, hit that subscribe button for us. 100,000 subscribers is just around the corner, and your subscription, like one man, does make a difference. Alright, without further delay, I present to you the top 10 things you might not know about Knight Rider. Number 1. You can thank a truck driver and a chimpanzee for Knight Rider. Prior to Knight Rider, creator Glenn A. Larson already had some other series under his belt, including the modest hit BJ and the Bear, starring Greg Evigan. BJ aired from 1978 through 1981 and featured a trucker and his pet chimpanzee that get into all sorts of misadventures. On one of those adventures, an episode that aired in September of 1979 called Kane's Cruiser, it featured a prototype supercar that was being abused by a hot-headed police chief, and BJ had to get it back. One of the viewers of that particular episode was Richard Lindheim, a TV executive at Universal Studios. Seeing the potential of a series revolving around a supercar, Lindheim tasked Larson with creating a new series around a car similar to the one in BJ. Larson and his wife flew to Hawaii to write the script, and 10 days later, the first draft of Knight Rider was complete. Number 2. Calling the show Knight Rider was not a sure bet. When Glenn Larson finished the still untitled script, he handed separate copies to both his wife and Carrie McCluggage, a senior vice president at the time at Universal Television. Larson had already named the main character Michael Knight, so when McCluggage and Larson's wife read the script, they both came up with the series name Knight Rider independently, and Glenn loved it. However, there was just one small problem. You see, the previous year in 1981, famed filmmaker George Romero had released a movie called Knight Riders, spelled with a K, all one word, starring Ed Harris. As the story goes, the studio had to negotiate with Romero to be allowed to use that same name, albeit now split up into two words and not the plural form, and thus the name Knight Rider was born. Number 3. Knight Rider, starring Don Johnson and Blair Underwood. The story of how David Hasselhoff was cast in Knight Rider is fairly well known at this point. David was on a plane when he was spotted by Brandon Tartikoff, the president of NBC at the time. Tartikoff arranged to get Hasselhoff in for an audition, and the rest is history. But what if that fateful airplane ride hadn't occurred? NBC execs were seriously considering some other actors for the role of Michael Knight, to include future Miami Vice star Don Johnson, and future Knight Rider alums Phil Coccoletti, Brian Cutler, and Jeffrey Osterhage. And while we're talking about what could have been, Mary Margaret Humes was considered for the role of Bonnie Barstow before losing out to Patricia McPherson. Future L.A. Law star Blair Underwood almost became RC3 before Peter Parros snagged the role, although Blair did get a consolation prize, that being a guest star role in Night of the Juggernaut, season 4 premiere. Kit as a Datsun 280ZX? Yes, in an alternate universe, Kit was not our beloved Trans Am, but rather a 1982 Datsun 280ZX. Harker Wade, a producer with Glenn Larson Productions, worked with a product placement firm called the Vista Group to secure the first three Trans Ams used as Kit in the pilot. However, early in the show's development, even before Larson wrote the first draft of the script, Wade and Vista Group president Eric Dahlquist briefly discussed using a brand new 1982 Datsun 280ZX instead. The idea didn't go any further than that brief discussion, as Larson had already made up his mind to use the all-new redesigned 1982 Trans Am instead, even going so far as to call the car the Trans Am 2000, or TAT, T-A-T-T, in his original treatment. In Larson's mind, it was the 82 Trans Am from the very start. But as a consolation prize, a Datsun 280ZX does appear in the pilot, driven by Lonnie, the character played by Sean Southwick. Number 5. My Partner, the Car. When Vista Group president Eric Dahlquist went to Pontiac's marketing director at the time, Jim Graham, to secure a few of the new Trans Ams for filming, Graham politely declined, citing that the idea sounded too much like one of TV's most infamous flops, My Mother, the Car. Undeterred by the rejection, Dahlquist next went to Bill Hoagland, Pontiac's general manager, who agreed to quietly pull some strings to get the studio the cars they needed to film a 30-minute pilot presentation video in hopes of selling the series to the network. On Friday, April 2, 1982, Dahlquist received a mysterious call that simply said, "There are three black Trans Ams waiting for you at the Van Nuys plant parking lot, with the keys in them. They are yours." Dahlquist, along with fellow Vista Group executive Chuck Koch and Knight Rider producer Harker Wade, immediately went to the lot, each got in their respective Trans Am, and drove off. Two of those TAs immediately went to customizer John Ward to modify the exterior. The third car went to designer Michael Chaffee to build the interior. Despite a popular rumor that persists to this day, the three Trans Ams were in fact not the first ones off the assembly line. For more information on that, check out the video we produced specifically on this topic. There's a link in the corner of this video right now. Number 6. The Time Kit Went Off the Rails. Filming of the series commenced in the summer of 1982, and it wasn't long before some of those original Trans Ams were in poor shape. The studio was able to add a couple more TAs to the fleet fairly early on, but it became clear that in order to do the types of stunts they wanted to do on the show, they would need more cars. Call it fate, call it luck, or call it karma. Yes, I stole that from Ghostbusters. The studio was about to get exactly what it needed. On Veterans Day of 1982, early in the morning before most people were up, the sleepy town of Selma, California was about to get thrust into the spotlight and forever be tied to our beloved show. The General Motors plant in Van Nuys, California was dispatching a train pulling an auto rack which contained 54 brand new 1983 Firebirds and Camaros. This particular train was headed north towards Canada, with some stops at dealers in the Pacific Northwest. On the night of November 10th, Veterans Day Eve, a particularly heavy rainstorm took place in Selma. Unbeknownst to all, that heavy rain had an unpleasant side effect. It soaked the rail bed. Early the next morning, the train carrying those new cars went over that soft rail bed, causing several of the train cars to derail. Fortunately, the accident happened on a holiday when traffic was light and no one was injured. However, the small town of Selma now had a big mess to clean up. Due to liability reasons, since those Firebirds and Camaros were in an accident, they could not be sold to the public. Instead of crushing them immediately, Vista Group worked out a deal to give those Firebirds to Knight Rider and the Fall Guy to use under the strict stipulation that once filming was done, those affected cars would be crushed. In fact, GM regularly sent a representative out to the set to confirm the cars were being used as agreed and were properly disposed of when the time came. Out of those 54 Firebirds and Camaros on that train that fateful day, one is still known to exist. It's not a Scream used kit, but more on that another time. Number 7. Toy cars and a dune buggy helped save countless Trans Ams. Knight Rider was in a unique position compared to other shows, like the Dukes of Hazzard. Unlike the 69 Charger used as the General Lee, the Trans Am used to depict Kit was brand new at the time, which meant the budget wasn't there to acquire hundreds of them to account for all the stunts that, in reality, would trash a regular Trans Am. They were fortunate with the train derailment that we just talked about, but even then, only those cars would go so far. Sure, they had a Trans Am beefed up with heavy-duty suspension and a roll cage, but even that car could only take so much abuse. The solution that the studio came up with was twofold. Within weeks of the show being picked up, a special dune buggy chassis with a Volkswagen motor called the Flivver car was built. This off-road car, with its heavy-duty suspension, was built specifically for jumping. A rubber Trans Am shell was placed on top to give the illusion that the car was actually a production line Trans Am. Now, if you want to learn all about the Flivver car, you're in luck. We also produce a video specifically on this unique car. There's a link in the corner of this video right now. Be sure to check it out. The other solution the studio came up with was to hire miniature model makers Jack Sessoms and Pete Slagle of Sessoms and Slagle Engineering. Using 1/8 scale models of Kit, Sessoms and Slagle filmed all kinds of wild stunts for the show that would seriously damage or destroy a regular Trans Am. Love it or hate it, the miniatures used in Knight Rider saved the lives of countless TAs. And yes, we actually did a video dedicated specifically on the miniatures. Once again, there's a link in the corner of this video. Be sure to take a look at it. Number 8. GMC was everywhere in Knight Rider. Did you ever notice how many GMC products popped up in the show? Now, we're not just talking about the GMC General that was used to pull the semi. We're talking about GMC Venduras, Jimmies, pickups, and loads of commercial tractors, Brigadiers, Astros. That's because of the aforementioned Vista Group, which had a contract with GMC to place their vehicles in movies, television series, and special events. For a while, GMC seemed to be in all of the popular productions of the day, especially the A-Team, right? Which you can also thank Vista Group for. Number 9. Knight Rider was canceled in part because executives didn't think it would have a life after NBC. It's true that Knight Rider was an expensive show to produce, coming in at over $1 million per episode in its final season. But executives were also concerned that the show wouldn't do well in syndication, a potentially lucrative second life for a show. The idea of putting out-of-production shows in syndication was a new idea at the time, but clearly, Knight Rider outperformed their expectations and flourished in that new model. How many of you fell in love with the show after it aired on NBC? You can thank syndication for that. The syndication package even offered the show as a 30-minute episode, cutting out most of the B storylines and dialogue. These 30-minute versions of the episode were mainly used when the station had programming that ran over schedule, such as a baseball game. And finally, our number 10 thing that you may not have known about Knight Rider. Some of the original kits survive to this day. Of the roughly 30 Firebirds and Trans Ams used to bring Kit to life during the 4 years the show was on the air, only 5 are known to exist today. As of the time of this recording, the original Season 1 and 2 Hero car, which later became the Seasons 3 and 4 right-hand blind drive car, currently resides in the Marconi Museum in Tustin, California. The drivable convertible car from Season 4 is on display at the Orlando Auto Museum inside the Desertland Park in Orlando, Florida. A general-purpose stunt car, which was later repurposed to be the Seasons 3 and 4 Hero car, is privately owned in the United Kingdom. The last two cars are owned by us, the Knight Rider historians. One is the Season 1 backup to the Hero car, which in Season 2 became the insert car, and it's the very same kit you see racing towards you in the opening seconds of the intro, which is really cool. That car is currently on loan to the Peterson Automotive Museum in Los Angeles, California. And the fifth car, our other one, is a season 3 and 4 stunt car, which is off display here in the United States, but you may have seen it on Jay Leno's garage back in 2018. And there you have it, 10 things you may not have known about Knight Rider. So tell us in the comments below, did you like this countdown? Should we do more of them? I don't know, maybe we should do top 10 things you didn't know about each episode. We'll turn it into a whole series. What do you guys think? Put it down in the comments below. Do me a favor, hit that subscribe button, hit that like button. Thanks so much for watching. We'll see you next time.
Hello, friends, it's me, Kit. When I'm not out fighting crime, I like to follow my friends at KnightRiderHistorians.com. Check it out.